Tell us a little bit about the concept, about the fairy tale, about the projections, about the, oh, it's changing color again there in the background, I can see. Yeah.
One word to combine the two parts, cooking and art. That was like underwater, or water was like the trigger for us. So I thought, what can I do to bring this thing, what can I bring to Thai people and you know, to people who come to this restaurant? Which is not too decorative and just hang something up the wall against the wall and that's it. So I thought it could be also like more than something active, like a interactive piece or something. So I came up with these water jars, which are called om in Thai. I might not pronounce that right, but yeah, something like that. It's five of them, five water jars, you see, which are filled up with a light. There's light bulbs hanging from the ceiling, and they are decorated, or they are painted with scenes from the fairy tale, a German fairy tale, which is called The Fisherman and His Wife, which is one of the most famous fairy tales from the Grimm brothers. The fairy tale is something very German, like, you know, very famous and symbolic. And combined it with something very Thai, which is these water jars are used to collect drinking water for centuries. So right now it's easier, you go to the tap, you get the water to the 7-Eleven and get your water. But if you live at the countryside or something, you can use them to collect water for the plants, and that's what they actually still do. They still use them actually, but not right in Bangkok. You just find them all over the place, like painted ceramics in different styles and sizes and shapes. So they are everywhere, so I thought, yeah, everybody knows it. That's a very, very rural element to use. And this is why they look so raw, right? It's clay pots, that's what it is.
Standing here with Daniel, who is the chef de cuisine right here at Reflections at the Plaza Athenae on Wireless Road in Bangkok City. You all also happen to be the other 50% of the concept of this underwater concept. We just had a long interview with Nick, very interesting, and now he's brought me like 50% down in to this concept and makes sense to me. Show me the rest of the concept. So you represent the food, is that right?
Absolutely, yeah. This is actually my restaurant. I work here full time. I invited Nick and we just were looking for a topic that works for both of us, that kind of like gives us enough to play with. And underwater is like a big field for food in general. I was scared that people would think of a captain's dinner. That was like my biggest fear, that it sounds like
fish fingers.
Yeah, fish fingers and seafood, like, I don't know, yabbies all you can eat. It isn't that at all, but water is like so essential to cooking in general, to all kinds of preparation of food. Well, after all, everything is mainly water.
Based out of water, yeah.
Yeah, but also in terms of cooking methods and in terms of what does it do, like if you boil something or steam it, or like where does water come in? And then, of course, also like what are the interesting products in the water that you don't necessarily think of when you think of water? Obviously, everybody has like a fish association or something like that. But actually, I don't even use any fish in the whole menu.
I think I kind of get it. So wait. So what we're saying, because, you know, I love cooking myself. I visit a lot of kitchens, and there's one basic thing that I always try to tell on my show or all my friends that want to learn about cooking, is the water. Is that you walk into a kitchen, boiling pot of water, and then spread that into different dishes, whatever concept that might be. Is that a little bit how you guys associate the two parts, the parts from the fairy tale of the wishes to the water in the kitchen to the different dishes?
Yeah. There's definitely like a strong connection.
I'm getting it.
there's this total fascination of water. And in the story, you have this fish in the water, like kind of hidden somewhere in the deep. You don't know where it goes to. The fisherman has to kind of summon the fish, and the fish comes up. And it's like that with dishes as well, right? Like you don't really know where the flavors go. You kind of have to, you know what to do to bring things up, but it's like, it's the same kind of mystery that you have in fairy tales, you often have in cooking as well. It's very scientific, and I like to use a lot of modern techniques where you feel like you control it, but in the end, what it tastes like is still a mystery, and so much stuff is not researched about it. And after all, dining is very emotional as well. And so there's so many factors that are more difficult to control. And this is kind of like the whole, I don't know, overhead of the story that I was trying to capture with this menu.
So would you say that, I don't know if I should call it surprise, factor, is that important at all for the guest coming in to dine here?
I'm not sure if I would call it surprise, but I think it's exactly like the, I think you mean the right thing. I'm just not sure if surprise is the right word. Like there's a lot of tableside preparations. We do a lot of things where we try to interact with the guest. There's a lot of things that happen at the table where I kind of make visible how do I make things and how do dishes come to be what they are. And this is, I don't know if surprise is the right word, but like it's definitely, you get a different feeling of what you're eating. Like you get a different understanding of the dish, and it kind of challenges you to think about it more than just eat it.
Well, awesome. I can't wait. So, that's a huge dinner, but it sounds very, very interesting. The whole concept with the art, the futuristic views of the dishes. So we're gonna go for a break. We're gonna let Daniel go back to the kitchen, getting prepared for tonight, and we're gonna do what we do best: to sit down, eat, drink, and enjoy. We're gonna go for a short break. Daniel, you're watching My Second Home. Don't go away.